Thank you, Phil, and everybody for having us here. I'm Sadie.
I am Brian.
Okay, let's do it.
All right, let's do it. Our slides are all the way in the back. It's kind of weird.
You can see right here.
Yeah. Oh, they're in the front too. Mm-hmm. That's awesome. Cool. All right. So so we are going to talk about a device that I'm sure at least some of you in the room have used, be it for personal and or business reasons, probably more on personal reasons. But we decided that we wanted to do this research because there's been some research into it, but honestly, there really isn't a whole lot yet. And as much as I don't like the idea of it, Zuckerberg is actually a fairly smart human being, and the metaverse seems to actually kind of starting to go places, to the tune of Apple has a ridiculously overpriced device that they also want you to buy now. So we know that it's actually going to become more and more mainstream. So obviously, our talk is going to be about the Oculus, and let's dive into it.
So, hi, my name is what? My name is who? My name is STEM Sadie. So, I'm Sadie Gauthier. I was 5 years at the NSA as a trained cryptanalyst, 2 years and counting now at SANS at their Research and Operations Center. I'm a public speaker about neurodiversity and chronic illness in the cybersecurity workspace. And a random fact about me, because Brian said that's required, is that I actually spiked on a polygraph question due to the fact that I was daydreaming about guacamole. So that's in my official file.
So for those who don't know me or have not heard about me before, hello, my name is Brian Moran. I do many things. I had a stint in the Air Force that lasted 13 years to all expense paid vacations to Iraq thrown in there, which was where I got my start kind of in this field and kind of just took off since then. Started my own company back in 2014. I've been doing that since. And the random fact about me, which has to go with the only Morans and the Duck Hut Ducks, is a couple of months ago at Topgolf in Baltimore, two ducks got stuck in the netting area and I helped actually like shoo them to safety. So of course I had to put a play on that. So now I actually have that logo and my name and two ducks on my golf bag, but with room in case I have to save more so I can just add them, like, you know, like a World War II fighter pilot or something like that. So the biggest thing for us is we started to kind of talk about this last year because so kind of going full circle on this is we've both used VR devices for sort of similar, but also different reasons. So first of all, like, who has actually used an Oculus or a VR device? That's pretty decent sampling. Yeah. How many of them are like strictly like personal use, like playing like Beat Saber or, you know, Fallen Jedi or anything like that?
Most of the people who already raised their hands, yep. It looks like it's personal.
Yep. Okay. What about who uses it for like healthcare services, for like mental health or anything like that, or rehab or anything like that?
Nobody.
Yes.
Well, once, a couple.
Yes, one. Yeah. So one of the best purchases that I've ever made in my life outside of spending $10 in Nashville to watch Jessica Hyde ride a bull was actually getting an Oculus and getting an app called Trip VR, which just is kind of like a meditation calming app. Like I have, you know, again, you've probably seen it, like I've done smartwatch research for years and the immediate calming effect that that app has on my like mental well-being is insane. Like it is worth the cost all by itself. And then of course, then we're like, well, what other data is there? Like, what else can we do? What else can we get from it? So we decided like, hey, we're actually going to use these for a while and see what kind of information we can get, but we didn't want to spend ridiculous amounts of money, like Cellebrite, Magnet, both great companies. I don't really want to spend $20,000 to see if I can get something off of an Oculus. Like, I'd rather not do that. I'd rather try to find a way to do it for free. And then once I get the information, kind of parse and collect it and then go from there. So obviously with that being said, like you go to any one of the, you go to a vendor and they're like, oh yeah, we support this. And it's like, well, how much of it do you actually support? Like, do you support acquisition of the device? Do you support acquisition of apps? Do you support, you know, some kind of myriad of the two? Do you just support like getting the data completely dumped from the, from the provider? In this case, it'd be primarily Meta. So obviously our first thing is like, we had to come up with new and kind of sort of unique ways to combat the problem of getting information from the device. So over the past 6 months, we each had an Oculus device in different locations. We're obviously up in Massachusetts, less Boston, although she lives nowhere near Boston. She lives with a bunch of chickens, literally, yep, in the wilderness. We had an iPhone, we had one T8 Plus, and we created two fake personas. So in the next data breach that Matt goes through and rolls out, like obviously we're gonna have our information exposed in there, which is why we created our fake accounts. So obviously one of the things that we wanted to do is kind of go through the process of like, well, what are these devices used for? Like, what are these devices used for on a regular basis? Because the cool thing is to be like, oh, like, let's jump in and go to a scene where we find this virtual, this virtual reality device. And what are we going to do with it? Like, how are we going to collect information from it? What do we even do with it? Do we just like put it on, strap in, and like get sucked into like some kind of like future world? Like, how does all of this work? So we wanted to take a step back and kind of look at it from not really so much a personal use mindset of like just primarily playing games, but like actually use it as an actual like augmentation device for like doing work or anything like that. And then seeing what kind of information is with there. And I will say the talk that we had planned to give is a very different talk from where this talk ended up going, simply because of the things that we found. And also that's one of the great things about research and presenting at conferences is, literally up to 3 weeks ago, like we had this whole path of where we're going to go. And it's like, we need to devote half the presentation to this because this is freaking epic. Like it's really, really interesting. Good.
I'm going to just show you.
All
right. Well, so how to set up the quest for data extraction. So on the headset, you have to enable in the Oculus app, the developer mode. So you connect, you click on that headset setting developer mode, click on the person icon, you register a group. It can be anything. So we picked our own group name. And then you click all the gray boxes and all that jazz. Then you go back to the mobile app and you browse to the headsetting developer mode, turn it on, and then you have to let the headset sync. So we were hanging out in a hotel and that took a very long time. So don't do it on a hotel Wi-Fi. And now all of your information belongs to Zuckerberg. Congratulations.
And of course, everybody knows about like the rumblings on what is still Twitter, regardless of whatever name they come up with it. But like, you knew that we weren't going to do a talk with Zuckerberg involved, and we're going to have some kind of reference of the cage match. They're just bonkers. So obviously, we have that. For all of you Meta employees, you're very welcome. For everybody who works for one of those other companies, I apologize, but it is what it is.
Apps, everybody. There are a lot of apps. There are two types of apps. So the Oculus apps that we use, so these are the apps actually on the Oculus. We used Facebook Messenger, since pretty much everybody's gonna use that. MetaQuest Chat, so that's chatting between each MetaQuest device. Virtual desktop, it is one of the top selling and most used in that MetaQuest app store. Also something that you would think of as a business case. So we decided to look into that. The MetaQuest browser. And then we also looked into Wolvik. So this is the old Mozilla Firefox browser. We also looked at files. The Oculus has its own, you can have files just on the Oculus. And then LastPass, because I thought it was really interesting to see a password manager on a VR headset. I don't know why they would do that. So then the mobile apps we used. So on our mobile devices, we had Quest, obviously, so you can talk to the Quest device, Facebook Messenger, LastPass. And then for the analysis part, I used Cydia and Filza. I never know how to pronounce that, but those were just so that I could look at the information that was given on the phone. So for the iOS related data, we originally, again, thought this talk was going to be more about data analysis. And it turned into something more incident response. So I wanted to definitely provide you with some of the interesting tidbits that we did find, but we will have to go into further analysis during our research as time goes on. So in the VAR mobile containers data application, and then there's an application ID folder on your iOS device. If you are looking for, I use the find command. If you're looking for anything related to the Oculus device, you're going to look for the name Twilight with a lowercase t. And that's going to give you that application ID that you need to be looking into. Weird thing, and we don't really know why, because it's not documented anywhere, but during the course of our research, that application ID did change. So I don't know why, what happened there, but it changed. If you're looking in VAR containers bundle application application ID, you have to use the big T Twilight in order to find all of the Oculus information on your iOS device. And of course, there were issues. This again delayed some of our research. So I have a jailbroken iPhone. If it's jailbroken, you can't power it down or else it's gonna figure, you know, not be jailbroken anymore. So us, we'll use low power mode because that will save the battery life. Well, Meta said, just kidding, you can't access the device if you're in lower power mode. Don't know why that's a thing, but so if you're trying to use low power mode, don't. Also, you can't set up an Oculus with a jailbroken iPhone. We don't know why, it just does not work. So what I had to do was use another phone to set up the MetaQuest. And then from my jailbroken phone, I could still access the app and everything. But in order to set up that account, you have to use a non-jailbroken iPhone. Also, with the jailbroken iPhone, had issues adding funds to the MetaQuest account. We don't know why. And on the jailbroken iPhone, you have trouble trying to get notifications to pop up on the Oculus headset. So Oculus has an option that you can get all of your phone notifications sent directly to your headset. But again, with the jailbroken iPhone, you can't enable that at all. So again, we are looking at what's on our mobile devices. We are looking on what's on the Meta device itself, the Oculus. But also we're thinking about, okay, well, what if we ask Meta for information? What information are we going to get from that cloud? So if you Google Meta login, there's actually two different things that you're going to look for because we actually missed number two. So I went back through it. So first for number one, you're going to click on the Meta link. That's that number one link. And this is, you're going to get sent to this MetaQuest login. You're going to use your MetaQuest account. And then there's a download your personal information icon. You're going to click that. It takes a little bit of time for them to get back to you. It was pretty short. It was like, I think, 1 or 2 days. Next. And this has all kinds of stuff in this request download. Oh, this is number two. I lied. Okay, number two. Number two was not the MetaQuest login, but this is the MetaQuest Oculus login. They're different, apparently. So if you go to the MetaQuest Oculus login, these are all the type of things that you're going to be able to access. You can access your profile, your subscriptions, your orders, all the different types of devices, people, your PIN number, your privacy settings, referrals, and all of that good stuff. Next one. You can also access the devices that you have registered to your Meta account. So that was mine, my MetaQuest 2. You can delete all the device data as you see there. We didn't go through that yet, but that would be something of interest to look forward to in our research. Next. They also have cloud backups and you can ask for, you know, things to be deleted. So you see here that Wolvik, which is the Mozilla Firefox browser, does store things to the Oculus cloud by default. Also interesting that the only other app that we saw that stored things to the cloud was Wolvik and LastPass. So, but Wolvik, you can delete your data as you see on the screen here. But on LastPass, you can't delete your cloud data. And again, these are all by defaults. So kind of interesting that you can do for one, but you can't do it for the other. Next. And so for the Oculus itself, how did we extract the data off the Oculus? Once we figured it out, it's actually quite simple and very low cost. We used ABD, we used Java, we used tar and a USB cable, and that was it. We didn't want to document everything, so the slide was really big, but if you want to know our exact steps, let us know, but that's pretty much the gist of it. And so when we looked into the device itself, the Oculus, the only applications that actually had data on the device, which of the all the apps that I had mentioned on the apps slide, were Wolvik, the Mozilla Firefox browser, and virtual desktop, but that's it. Next. So for Wolvik, this is that's the directory where you're gonna find, if you pull it off the Oculus, that's where you're gonna find the Wolvik data. Again, we didn't go deep dive into the analysis, but the F directory contains typical Mozilla Firefox browser files, including a Windows state JSON, a key4.db, places.sqlite, and a SQL database for cookies, form histories, et cetera. The SP directory, it has some XML files and they refer to connection keys, connection secrets, passworded, which are UTF-8 encoded strings and more. For virtual desktop, there's the destination that you're gonna look for. In the F directory, there is some user settings JSON that houses information such as your computer ID. and your last login, I believe, is up there. I can't really see from here. Sorry. Yes, your last computer ID, which we think is interesting in terms of your virtual desktop connection, right? And then there's another directory that contains your connection secret, your connection key, and your device ID. So these are all good identifiers. And again, we didn't deep dive into it, but it'd be interesting to see how these are used or if they could be used, you know, nefariously.
So that obviously the iOS side is what Sadie covered. The Android side, unfortunately, took a very unexpected turn that I was not expecting at all. So for everybody who has dealt with mobile phones in the past, you know that mobile phone extractions are pretty much like the bane of our existence. Like all it takes is one small thing with a mobile extraction or mobile device, and like we lose the potential to actually access everything. And that's exactly what happened on my fully jailbroken, completely de-Googlified everything 8T. So somehow, and I still to this day have no idea how, I actually got an OTA security patch update, even though I'm not supposed to get those. And as soon as that happened, my phone actually updated the kernel and just went in a continual loop mode. So it just was stuck in bootloader and would just loop continuously. So forever, again, everybody who has done mobile phone distractions in the past, like, you know, once that happens, all of that data on the phone is gone. It's been encrypted. It is gone forever. So the only way to actually kind of do a full reset is to literally fully reset the phone, hopefully be able to get it back in the state that you need it to, and then get all the information again. So although I lost all of the Android data that I was planning to collect from it, like it was actually kind of beneficial because it gave another path into actually the device usage piece, which was kind of the really like, oh my goodness, this is just unreal eye-opening moment for us. But with that being said, like we still plan to get it restored. Obviously we have the Fast and the Furious theme. So we're going to try to do this for like the next 10 years and just have like a multi-sequel franchise going, probably some Netflix series, whatever we can possibly do, like keep this going. So like, obviously we want to do the research. We want to get all the information possible, but this goes to show like, despite the best laid plans, like even with any presentation, like there's always going to be sidekicks and pitfalls and detours, and you just have to kind of adjust with it as we go. So with that being said, there was, I would say probably 25, 30, 30 people in the crowd who've used the virtual headset devices. How many use them for work?
Nobody.
How about not work? Who has thought about using it for work? Who has thought about using it for like accessing other people's computers?
A couple.
Yeah, a couple. Okay. For all of you who work in, control like your environments, looking for security threats and everything like that, who is looking for Oculus devices on your network right now? Nobody. Who is going to be making immediately panicked phone calls in about 5 minutes being like, oh my gosh, we need to look for all of this crap right now because this is actually ridiculous. And that's probably everybody who has an IR focus. So virtual desktop, and this is where this presentation ended up going, which again was not what we expected at all. So this is one of the most popular apps on the Oculus. My theory for that on why it's so popular actually has nothing to do with so much using it for work. It's using it to like watch videos with friends, the streaming application stuff, everything like that. Like
gaming.
That's probably why we think that it's so popular. But regardless of that, it is incredibly popular, and that is really good, but also potentially really, really bad. So once you download the app, you pay the $20, you can fill in your usernames, and that's literally it. You run this application on a computer, and there is no additional authentication that occurs. There is no anything else that happens. Like you have access to that computer as long as your username is in that program, and that literally is it. Like, yeah. So there's no anything, as you will see. So obviously, again, if you know me, I love pugs. So I had to throw in my, oh my God, remote desktop meme in there.
Well, that's how we felt when we found this out.
Yeah.
Oh my God,
yes. Remote desktop. So, when you have a typical remote logon to a system, like you're expecting, to see certain event IDs, you're expecting to see certain connections in rather than other event logs. That doesn't happen with this application at all, because the user is already authenticated to the system, and all this application does is just run, and that's it. Like you don't have to be clever and have some kind of like cool SSH tunnel or tunnel out through DNS or VoIP or anything like that. You literally just run this application, and you just pop up your Oculus headset with your username on it. And if it's on that computer, like, you can connect and literally do anything that you want to do. And there is no evidence whatsoever that you have that remote connection into your system.
You don't even need a password, anything.
Yeah. Yeah. This is literally it. So you just fill in. So we have found that those other, the other accounts are associated with other virtual reality headsets in other parts of the world. Because our first thing was like, what the heck is a Pico and Vive port? So literally you fill it in. The good news is you only have 4 accounts that you can fill in per platform. So you can't just like wildcard star and just have everything potentially access your system. But you just run this application on the endpoint, you put in your username, and literally that is it. You have full access to the system.
And in that example, my fake account was Capercrom and his is...
Yes.
Yeah,
Bride Marv.
And this was being set up on his personal computer.
Yep.
Or test computer.
Yep. So for those of you who have used Oculus, this, you know, kind of dashboard thing looks sort of similar. This is actually launching the remote desktop application. Pretty straightforward. Comes up, you know, with any kind of typical application. Again, pretty straightforward for those of you who have seen the Oculus. For those of you who not, this is kind of what the metaverse looks like, except nobody has legs yet, as far as I know. Sure. So literally power it on, connect it to the network, and this application just sits waiting for computers to pop up, which kind of sounds like a sort of like a C2 beacon thing, as you just wait for something to pop up, doesn't it? Like the parallels here are just scary. So once computer pops up, so this is laptop was actually repurposed during the start of the pandemic, when I subcontracted with Basis to create the autopsy training. We had the anti-rendic group computer system and everything like that. So this is where this all ties back to. So also for all of you who, like me, who hoard all of your devices, like 4 years down the road, like, I might be using that laptop or something that's really, really useful. So this, I actually opened my Chrome browser after Sadie logged in and did her stuff on the computer. And I was shocked because she automatically logged into Facebook. She didn't choose to log into Facebook on my system. She just automatically logged in once the connection happened. So my first thought was, oh, like, I somehow inadvertently, like, you know, after a night of having a very small amount of adult beverages, probably like 12, like, I accidentally took her account information, logged it into mine. And no, that was not the case. It just populated and that was it. So because she connected on my computer, I could see, oh, I have a Facebook account that is with her. Like, that's really cool, but also kind of like freaky because she didn't have to do anything. She literally just authenticated the computer and that was it.
Well, I did log in and I did log into Facebook, but I definitely logged out.
Yes.
That's the point.
Yep.
So.
Yep. So Sadie being the artist that she is, as Matt alluded to, like, I probably have lesser skills than Matt has. So I have no artistic ability. Like, she left a sticky note on a desktop and it's adorable, right? It's adorable. But imagine if you log into your computer in the morning and then all of a sudden there's just like some sticky note. It's like, haha, like LOL, we ransomed you. And then you're like, well, what's going on here? Like, I don't understand how this is. And I obviously, this is what it looked like from the virtual desktop application. Like, it's my computer, it's my screen, but I can actually access everything with an awesome looking headset and a couple of hand controllers. So again, you have full control of the computer, you can do whatever you want. For those of you who have not seen Leonard Nimoy sing about the hobbits, I expect you all to do that immediately after this presentation. Your life will never be the same. Spock and hobbits is the intermix that I never knew that I needed until I actually found it. So again, just going through, it's like, okay, like browsing YouTube, doing everything, like, yeah, this is pretty, pretty cool. Again, the artistic ability. Sadie left this beautiful present for me on my desktop. And literally I just logged in my computer and all of a sudden it was just there. Like, it's just mind blowing that, like, okay, like, she did a bunch of stuff, which I literally had no idea about. And then of course my immediate question was, well, how can I find out how much information is actually there?
Before you go on, I mean, this all, I didn't tell him when I was gonna log in, I didn't tell him that I logged out. I opened my browser again in the VR headset. It said, hey, you have a computer to connect to. I clicked on it. I didn't need a password. I went into his machine. You don't know this, so surprise. I actually downloaded an application by accident on your computer and then had to uninstall it. So you don't even know that happened.
That's why the FBI visited me. Cool.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
It wasn't like anything crazy. It was like sticky notes. Yeah. It was like something sticky notes-esque, but I was like, oh my God. So you can download anything onto the person's computer. They're not really going to know unless they check those logs. I made all this stuff and then I exited out and he only knew that I was in there because of that sticky note.
Yep. So this is truly an evidence of, like, something happened on my computer, but I swear to God, it wasn't me. It was not me. And 100%, but as again, as analysts, like we're going to go look through and try to find our remote logons. We're going to try to find our evidence of potential remote access, everything like that. And literally she could have done anything on my computer and she did anything on my computer and I didn't even know. So of course, you know, we go through the event logs, we look for everything. There is no authentication because I logged in as my username on that account. And all I had to do is run this remote desktop application. And it just sits there waiting for the Oculus to pop up. And once it populates, it connects and that's it. There are very few registry entries associated with this particular program. There is some sort of configuration file because it saves the usernames, but we haven't found exactly where that is yet. There's very little data that's actually stored there. So I'm thinking it's probably in the registry, but I haven't been able to confirm that yet because we haven't actually done like the full application dump, look at the ports and everything like that. But that all the ports goes back to, again, like we're expecting to see authentication because you figure you come from the outside into a computer, like you're gonna have your remote desktop connections, everything like that. This application does it all for you. This is your free tunnel into your environment to literally have free reign to do whatever you want. And the only thing you have is you have a username that is running this account and literally that's it. Like there is no logging, there is no oversight, there is no anything.
I was able to get on the network.
Yep.
It was crazy.
Yep. Yep. She printed off a bunch of pictures on my printer and, you know, I'm pretty sure that all of my Google Home devices now like respond in Russian or something, but that's also just because I used to work in NSA. So it's entirely possible. Yeah.
So obviously there are security implications, but according to Discord, it's all okay because otherwise why would they allow this at the Metastore, right? So I actually Googled this. Once we figured this out, I Googled it and I said, you know, I looked up for this error and there's nothing about it. There's a lot of people asking, is this safe? Is this okay? And they keep tagging Meta and Facebook and they keep being, and obviously there's no response from them. But as you can see at the bottom here, everyone says, well, you know, if it really was a security issue, it wouldn't be allowed on the App Store.
Yep.
So we don't want to call you guys out, but this is how we felt when we read that. Yeah. You know. So
if Dentex, if you're here or watching online, I apologize.
We're sorry.
Publicly calling you out, but bro, that's a dumb take.
He's also not the only one though.
Yeah.
He's not the only one. Everybody's thinking it.
Yeah. So obviously, you know, like we're trying to stay on the front lines of exploits and protecting our environments and everything like that. We are blue, in the most part, like in this room, we are blue teamers. We are defenders. We are not red team, like pretty much the closest we get to red team is hanging out with dual core once in a while and buying some kind of hacker shirts that Kevin Pagano made. Like that's pretty much the extent of my red team experience. And to be honest, I don't really want to dive into that. But, you know, down in DC, over in Russia, over in China, like you have these massive just office cubicles, which are just filled with people with computers. And like, this is what we thought APT was going to look like when they're coming in an environment and stealing all our stuff. And this is probably what it's actually looking like because you just run the application. And it's like, oh, look, they just got Equifax again. Imagine that. Like, God, it was so easy. So, you know, with all of this, like, we obviously have our path forward and proceed.
So, yeah, there's definitely a path forward. Obviously, we have the data analysis that on all the data that we've gotten. But again, it's really about, you know, that username, right? And if you're able to get that username into somebody else's virtual desktop application, you're going to have access to their system. So as the Oculus 3 comes out, because they've had other, we used Oculus 2. So there's an Oculus 1, there's an Oculus Go, there's an Oculus something else. As Oculus 3 comes out, we're wondering how is Meta going to handle providing secure services for all of these devices? And also the more context you know, the more varied data. So if you guys are interested in this, come join us in the metaverse and let's see what else we can find. Because right now it was just us two hanging out, talking back and forth. But if we add a third person in, you know, we want to see where we can get. We also need to do a deep dive into those mobile forensics. So where my pal's at, hit me up because not a mobile expert. And then we're thinking about new scenarios. So this project also wasn't just about, hey, what kind of data can we get off of it? It's, you know, what can you use this Oculus data for? So for example, if you're in a raid, right, and you're taking all the devices and you see an Oculus device, don't take it out of the network. Put it on. Let's see what's in there, right? Because a lot of the times, if it's not powered off, you don't need the pin sometimes to get in. So put it on and you can see maybe, hey, do they have virtual desktop loaded on the Oculus? Maybe they do. And that's going to auto-populate all the computers that they have access to, right? Maybe those computers are hidden somewhere in this room. Is there a hidden laptop somewhere? So there are all kinds of scenarios where this could really be important. Another scenario is when you have one Quest account, you can access it via different phones. So, which is interesting. So as you can, you have to register your Oculus with one phone, but after that, as long as you have the Quest app on any mobile device, you can just access it there. So with multiple phones accessing the Quest data, does that lead to more artifacts? Does that lead to more things that we can figure out? Another thing that we didn't dive into is the Meta Oculus data request that we pulled down. It has lists of past computer IDs that you've been to, right? So he might not have seen that I was able to get on his computer, but I probably can see the last computer ID that I showed you guys in that in the data, in the Oculus device data, I showed you that. So I know what the last computer I saw, but if you are able to get a request or a subpoena for that information, you can probably see all of the computers that that person has had access to and graph that network. So lots of really, really cool possible uses for this. And again, as Brian said in the beginning, this is just something that's so under-researched. And instead of focusing on just what can we physically get off the Oculus, we need to think bigger about how the security implications are for everybody who are using this device.
Yep. And again, apologies to all of you other person fans, but obviously he's crying Doge tears. And obviously, like, Zuck would absolutely beat the crap out of a certain other individual. So I'd also like to point out, you know, this is our contact information. This is the first time that I've actually done a presentation where something has been on the slide other than Twitter. That's kind of like, oh, like I think I cried some tears over that. But yeah, like, you know, we'd love to talk about people who have questions or comments or anything like that. And people who also have, you know, kind of thought outside the box a little bit on this. It's like, oh, well, I just use this for Beat Saber and everything like that. It's like, well, what else could you potentially use this for? And then it's just kind of eye-opening. Like, it really reminds me of kind of the start of the smartphone era right now with these devices. So like, let's try to get ahead of it as quickly as possible.
And for those who are new to DFIR and want to be involved, we're hopefully going to post something about our exact steps, but this is a low cost and effective way to get data off of this device. So if you're interested in getting involved in DFIR and you're curious about the Oculus, we're trying to provide you a free way to join our research. So take this opportunity, reach out to us and just become involved.
Yep.
So thank you, everybody.
Thank you.